Hello, hello.
We're starting.
We're getting started, folks. How's everybody doing? Hi, everyone. How are you? I'm just going to go over to this screen for a minute while we get started. So,
hello.
I wanted to see if we're getting started, folks. If you guys, sorry, I think I was just playing myself back to you through the tubes of you. So, all right, we're going to do a lot of things today in today's stream. And I am going to cut this apart, but I'm going to leave the whole thing on YouTube as well. I wasn't doing that before, but I think I have a much better setup now and a better way to stream and la, la, la. So I think everything's looking good, but I am going to cut it into shorter things for YouTube later so that you guys can quickly reference it if you want to and you don't have to scroll through like an 8-hour stream. Everybody say hi to the chomp. He's passed out back there. So, the chomp is my dog, in case you guys haven't ever met him before. So he's probably going to wander in and out. He likes sleeping on the thing when I'm working, so I figured I'd just leave him there for you guys. But everything's working pretty good and looking pretty good right now on the stream. I'm pretty happy with it. I'm just going to do one thing, where, all right, I think we're all good. Anyway, let's get rolling here. So what I wanted to do first is do some, I wanted to do some of the, warming up, vocal warm-ups. Sorry, guys. Whenever I start the stream, I get a little distracted because I'm always looking back at, you know, how is the stream health? How's everything going? Blah, 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 blah. So, I think that, I think everything's going well, though. It looks like it looks and sounds good. So yeah, I'm streaming to Facebook and YouTube right now. I wanted to stream to Twitch, but I always have a hard time getting it to connect to Twitch for some reason. I don't know why. So Twitch didn't really work very well today. But we're here on the tubes of you. So let's try to do some vocal warm-ups. So the warm-ups we're going to do today, everybody, are about the, where'd my software go? Show my thing. Why don't you show my thing? I want to show you guys, what I'm doing here. And I'm just going to bring in GarageBand because I'm doing my piano tones through here for you guys. So you should be able to hear that. And the vocal warm-ups we're going to start with today are so that you can warm your voice up for clean and harsh vocals. I'm going to be streaming for a few hours today. If you feel like you're getting something out of the stream and you're enjoying the stream, thank you for giving me a subscribe, especially here on YouTube. And on Facebook here, I have to be honest, I'm not really using the platform much, but I was able to restream to it, which is really fun. So if you want to follow me on Facebook, that's great. But I think I'd definitely prefer if you followed me on Instagram, YouTube. Those are my platforms. I kind of believe in the philosophy of using YouTube as, you know, a thing that you do, or I'm sorry, the philosophy of only getting good at like one or two social media platforms instead of every single one, I feel like. So yeah, but thank you for supporting the channel, supporting everything that I do. I'm here to teach you guys. I'm here to you know, I'm gonna turn off these widgets. I don't actually think they're working. Sorry about this, guys. But if you make a donation or a tip or anything, it'll come up on the screen when you do it. That is working. And it'll leave a little thing. My little jar here will fill up if you subscribe, if you comment, if you tip, whatever you do, it'll end up here. So thanks, everybody. And let's get started. So we're going to do vocal warm-ups for people who do clean or harsh vocals. You can sing along with me. I'm just using GarageBand to give us a piano tone and control the MIDI here. And it's much easier to sing along to the piano. So we're going to try and listen to that and try to sing with that. So today's vocal warm-ups, the biggest thing that I have for clean and harsh vocalists is that you need to do things that stretch and relieve tension, especially if you're doing something, excuse me, like fry screaming. This last week, I kind of had a video up about false chord versus fry screaming. And we have to remember that fry screaming is a compressed vocal cord technique with the vocal folds shut. They kind of look like this if I were to make my lips sort of represent the vocal cords. Like that. And so they require a lot of compression strength. Fry screamers can get a lot of tension and it can have issues even with something we call tension dysphonia. And so we're going to try to avoid all of that. We're going to do a little bit of singing and we're going to get ready as though you were going to sing clean or harsh. So it's just going to be a warm-up routine for all vocal ranges, but it's going to be really focused on relieving tension, which is good whether you do clean or harsh. And if you guys have any questions as we're going along, feel free to throw it in the chat here. And on YouTube, we've got the chat right there. So yeah, it's going to be great. So let's start with lows. So we're going to start in the bass baritone range. If you're a mezzo or a soprano, you're going to want to wait a little bit. You're going to come in. I'm going to tell you where to come in. We start with bass, then we go to baritone, tenor, which would be the same as like my voice range, contralto, then mezzo, soprano, and soprano. So we're going to go low to high just because it's easier to go in that order from the piano. So let's start with... And by the way, everybody, I listed in the chat all the things I'm going to be doing today. So if you don't feel like hanging out for vocal warm-ups, come back in a couple hours. I'm going to be doing all kinds of things. I'm going to tell you how you can get me to react to your vocals. It's all cool. It's going to be fun today. So let's start with vocal warm-ups right now. First, actually, everybody, let's do breathing calibrations. One of my favorite things to do is to have you guys do breathing calibrations before you begin vocal warm-ups, especially if you're going to do harsh vocals. So first breathing calibration is to reset your inhale. So we're going to roll the shoulders back. We're going to sit nice and tall. We're going to put both feet on the ground. And you're going to take one hand and you're going to put it on your side rib here like this. And try to make sure that it's on your rib cage and it's not on your squishy waist area. And we're going to imagine that we have a piece of tape or string wrapped around the rib cage, right where our hand is. We're going to inhale through the mouth. We're going to break out of that tape 360. And then we're going to exhale like normal. So we're going to do this three times. So this is preparing your inhale for singing or screaming. So here we go. 360 inhale together. Exhale normal. Second one. Here we go. Exhale normal. You're looking for a round 360, like you're breaking out of the imaginary tape. Second one. Here we go. I'm sorry. Third one. Last one. Here we go. Exhale like normal. Very good. Very good. Okay, let's do the second breathing calibration, which is going to calibrate your inhale. So we're doing these before we do our vocal warm-ups. So we're going to do, I'm sorry, this is going to calibrate your exhale. We're going to do a long hiss out. We're going to lift from the center of the chest. We're going to feel the abs contracting, particularly at the end of the phrase. And you're just going to mentally screenshot this and memorize how that ab contraction feels. The stomach is your gas pedal, whether you're singing or screaming. So let's capture that. We're going to take a deep breath in, long hiss out, lifting from the center of the chest, feeling that abdominal flex and memorizing it. And you only go till you run out naturally, just however long you can go individually. There's no set length of time. And this one is not about going for longer. It's just about capturing the ab squeeze. So let's try it. Deep breath in, long hiss out, lifting from the center. Here we go. Lifting, 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 lifting. Keep going, keep going, keep going. Lifting, lifting, lifting from the center. Kind of keep your hiss medium loud so it doesn't take you forever. Go till you run out, even if that's not very long. Stay up. Imagine low string pulling you up from the chest. You're going to feel the abs crunch. Screenshot it. Memorize it. Stay up till you run out. If it's taking a real long time, blow out more air. Make it louder. Lift, 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 lift. And when you feel that crunch, and you can't go any further, you can let go. And you can breathe normal. Very good. So screenshot in your mind and memorize that crunch. You know what I mean? It's going to be really good. You're going to feel great about it. And I think you're going to have a good grasp. It recalibrates your inhale and your exhale for singing or screaming. So let's do singing warm-ups. And even if you're a harsh vocalist, you want to do singing warm-ups with your voice. And the reason you want to do that is because you've got to release muscle tension in here. We talked just a minute ago about fry or screamers needing to do that. And also you need to dilate your blood vessels and you need to do that slowly. You can't go 0 to 60. It's really common to get vocal injuries like 0 to 60, going from super cold to a scream. So let's start. We're going to go from, like I said, bass all the way through soprano. And we're going to do a very efficient exercise that I call the octave exercise. And this is going to be, if I was going to play this on the piano, it'd be like 1, 3, 5, 8, 5, 3, 1. If for those of you that know music theory, if you don't know anything like that, you can still sing along, you know? And if you're not even sure where your vocal range is, try to guess, try to jump in with me. If it's uncomfortable, like it feels too low, then just wait, you know? If it feels tense, you're singing along and it starts to get too high, well, then let go and don't force it, okay? So just feel it out. So we're going to start with basses. I'm going to sing the exercise first a little higher than where I'm going to start because otherwise I can't sing it. I have a very low voice, but it's not a bass. So I'm going to sing it up here, but then basses, we're going to start lower. This is going to be like... So I'm writing in the chat here, you know, we want to... sing on a Z today. It's going to be in our regular belting, aka chest voice, kind of rock metal voice, normal non-falsetto singing voice. And this will apply to you too, ladies. I don't want a lot of head voice in this exercise. This is going to be like a belting exercise. So let's start it. But basses, we're going to start really low. Down here where I can't sing, but you're going to sing the Z just like I just did along with this. And we're going to go up each time in the same note pattern to the next closest note. We're not going to be jumping around. And baritones, I will let you know when you can join the party. So basses, here we go. Ready. Singing with the piano on a Z. Breathe. So, baritones, you can join in now. That's like my lowest note, but baritones, you can join in. I would be more in like the tenor range, so we still want to wait if you think you're tenor voice. And so this is basses and baritones together. Here we go. You breathe in between. So Oh, tenors, I think you can join. So everybody bass through tenor, here we go, or super low contraltos like myself. So we're gonna start here with. Here you go, ready everybody? Basses, hang in there. No falsetto. This is just a belting exercise. Bass through tenor. You should all be here. Basses, this is getting towards the end, but hang on. One more basses, last one. Here we go. All right, now mezzo sopranos, you can start joining us now. Basses, you'll be done. You're out. So baritone, tenor, and mezzos. Here we go. Sopranos, you're still waiting. Stay belting. If you're flipping to falsetto, drop out. Or if you're trying to use a head voice, drop out. We want a belt. It's going to sound like zzzz. Baritones, you can stay with us. Try to stay with us. One more baritones. So baritones, you can probably drop out now. If you could belt that high, that's probably your max belting. Now we're just looking at sopranos. You can finally join us. So we have sopranos, mezzos, and tenor slash contralto right now. And some of you tenors, this might be getting a little high for your technique as well. If it's uncomfortable, drop out. But if it's comfortable, stay with me for a couple notes. Sopranos, you're just joining us. Mezzos, you're sticking with us. Here we go on the Z. No head voice, belting. Z. Keep going. Okay, so tenors, you should be done now. And mezzos too. You might not really be getting much more up here. Mezzos, if you feel comfortable, keep going. Otherwise, this might just be just the sopranos. Because this is a belting exercise. So this is not meant to go in your full vocal range. It's not meant to go in your head voice, if you will. So we're going to keep belting here, just sopranos. Here we go. Belting only. Everyone else should be done. Sopranos, you can stay belting pretty high. If you're flipping, stop. Give me a couple more sopranos if you can. Last one. Might seem crazy. We ended on a G5, but there are sopranos who can belt to a G5. Look at Kelly Clarkson, Celine Dion, Ariana Grande. I mean, many of these folks can do that. So yeah, that was the warm-up, the first warm-up. So we did breathing and the octave exercise. Let's go ahead and do a couple more. So the next thing we're going to do is everybody's just going to do this together. We're going to do a rainbow SZ, like like sizz or suzz. And this one I do want to do in a falsetto or a head voice kind of tone. Sizz, sizz. And it's very yawning and floating, but whether you're a bass or a soprano, I want you to do it where it is comfortable for you. Wherever it's comfortable for you to get at this tone. So let's do this up in your, you want to think of it as floating and yawning and in your own comfortable falsetto relative to you. So you're going to take the arms and you're going to go it up over the top of the head. And we're going to make a half jumping jack on the top of this rainbow. So this rainbow SZ. So we're going to go like, I want you guys to impersonate me. And if for you, you have a low voice and maybe it's more comfortable like, that's fine. Just do it relative to you. If you have a higher voice than me and you can get up all the way into the whistle tones at this, sopranos and folks, go ahead and do that too, okay? So let's try it. Let's do our rainbow SZ. Here we go together. Big breath in, arms on the top. Very good, everybody. Let's do second one, last one. Here we go. Try to connect it. Try not to let any like little gaps come in there. Very good, everybody. So these are just some basic warm-ups to get you rolling for your clean or your harsh vocals. And that's totally up to you how you want to do it. But you could be ready to scream right now if you wanted to. You know, whatever you feel like doing. I have to record some harsh vocals today. And I was going to hopefully do some of that with you guys here on the channel to help you learn how to do that. But I think that for now, what we'll go ahead and do is we'll get to some reactions. Today, I wanted to put a different spin on the reactions, though. And if you enjoyed that warm-up or you're enjoying the stream, there's a link, or you can use the super chat if you're here on YouTube. There's a link to the tip jar, and you can throw something in there if you feel like it. Thank you guys so much for supporting everything I do in the channel. I try to help you guys out. My mission is to help you guys and help you learn how to sing and scream safely. Let's go ahead and let's start reacting. I want to put a different spin on the reactions today, though. And that is I want to take a look at some screams that are not what you guys think. I want to look at screaming not from new artists or band songs or anything. I want to look at, you know, screams from actors, like scream queen things. What is the difference between that and our harsh vocals? And we should take a real close look at that today because it is a totally different thing. I've had a lot of actor clients. I've coached a number of actors, and there's a number of ways you can use harsh vocals in acting, but it's a little different that if you decide to use it in acting for video games or for anime instead of, or for an animated anything really, not just anime, but, or instead of using them for a live action movie. In a live action film, you're going to have to scream in a pretty realistic way. And I think that it's kind of dangerous, actually. It's really hard to scream that way. But let's try to take a look and see what's going on with some of our streaming stuff. I mean, our screaming stuff, not streaming. I'm streaming right now. I want to see. Sorry, guys. I'm looking in at some of my YouTube stuff going on here and just seeing how the live stream is going. Everything seems to be going really good, though. So, yeah, it's really exciting. Let's go ahead and get started with our stream. Our reactions here. So, first thing we're going to react to are scream queens here on YouTube. Later, I'm going to tell you guys how, in a couple of hours, I'm going to give you the opportunity to have me react to you. But that's going to have a little bit of, you'll have to be able to do something to make that happen. Oops, there's a fly in here, I guess. And we're going to make sure that, you know, that you have the opportunity to do that. If you want me to react to your screams and your vocals, we're going to take a look at that in a few hours. But for right now, I'm going to react to some screams from movies and compilations of legendary scream queens, if you will, from horror movies from back in the day. All right, so here we are. We're gonna Sorry, guys. I'm just having trouble finding the one that I wanted to use. I think it's this one. Yeah. Let's look at top 10 scream queens. All right. Let me just grab the source for you guys, and then we'll switch it on over to there. Well, I guess it doesn't like me. We'll see if I can get it to show up. That's the one thing I don't like about streaming is it is a little hard to make everything work. There we go. The Scream Queens on YouTube. Let's see what happens when I make it big.
Let's make it big.
I don't know if I like that. All right, guys. I think this is going to work really good. Yeah, there it is. This is what I wanted to share with y'all. So let's react to this, because this is going to be talking about the difference between horror movie screams and regular screams. And that is a big, and like the harsh vocals that I teach. So let's start by prefacing that I just said that even for my actor clients, doing the type of harsh vocals we do in rock and metal, like the Fry scream and all this stuff, or even voice with distortion. Hey, you know, that's my Fry, my voice with distortion, all this cool stuff. This is not going to sound very realistic in a horror movie. So you get this kind of catch 22 with actors. If you have a suspension of disbelief involved, like it's a video game, it's a cartoon, you know, whatever it may be, then you can use like a Fry scream. So for example, I call it escalating. Like if I was going to teach somebody who's going to do an anime character and they're going to go into a scream, they can, because it's got this element of it's not real because it's animated, they can escalate to a Fry scream and it works very well. Why won't you leave me alone? You know, this kind of a sound. And that would actually translate really well in an animated scenario for a creature or a fictional character or even a video game. But one thing that doesn't translate extremely well is the... It is basically like real acting, like when what we're about to react to here. So you really need to make it. I think you really need to make it realistic, and it's pretty dangerous to do that. Real screams, but we're going to talk about how some of these actors do it. We are going to hear some things in here that are like real screams, but actually could potentially not make you as hoarse as regular things. As like regular yelling, we're gonna hear some like whistle tones. So yeah, I just want to let's go ahead and check it out. So let's react. Let's see what these scream queens sound like. Okay, so right away, I want to point out a couple things we're hearing here because we're going to keep hearing it. So as I was mentioning, the big difference between, you know, the big, huge difference between each of these people and the big, huge difference between like real hoarseness screaming and what these folks are doing is the whistle harmonics. So when we're doing this, the whistle harmonics are these, you hear these super harmonics from these folks. So right away, the first three vocalists are, well, not vocalists, actors that we saw here, they had extremely high super harmonics in their screams. So not only are they screaming in a voiced sense. This is not doing what we do in the type of vocals that I teach, which is using the other folds to create distortion. They're doing this with their true folds, but they are saving their voice just a little bit by using their own whistle tones. And I don't know if that makes sense to you guys, but those are these whistle harmonics we're hearing. It gives the scream this edge here. And if you can get your voice to go into whistle harmonics, even for a realistic sounding scream that is using your true fold, you can probably save yourself from going super hoarse. So let's keep looking at this. Lots of whistles. Holy cow. Here we go.
So the owners had to close the hotel down and were forced to sell it. Nobody came through here again until the 60s. And ever since then, people have reported seeing the ghost of Madeline O'Malley roaming the hallways waiting for her lover.
Where's the scream? Some
say she's even looking to take up a new one.
Okay, so that scream, let's go back. Oh, that scream was like, bleh, bleh, please. I don't know. I can't even do it. It's really bad. It was more like a pleh, please. Like, see, I just want to go into metal harsh vocals. I have a hard time doing things like this, acting things with true folds, because I'm trying not to make myself hoarse. But that middle one that she did where she said, please, that had a lot of like false folds flapping in it. It didn't have any whistle tones, but you could definitely prevent yourself from going hoarse. It's kind of a good way to do it. Like that. That was almost a false chord scream there. Please, you know, like on a higher voice tone, kind of like that. So we're activating a lot of other tissues there. So that one actually saved that person's true folds.
Why am I here?
I'm hoping we can get to the bottom of that mystery together. Let's discuss what happened yesterday, Preston.
What's the first thing you remember?
Something creepy's gonna happen. Okay, so that's definitely one that has a lot of whistle tones in it.
What is it? What's the matter?
So that scream relied on the whistle harmonics. But every time I've ever tried to do these personally, I've gone hoarse. I really don't recommend trying to scream like this out of nowhere.
Get out! Get out!
What?
Behind us! There's no one in that truck! Watching your
footsteps. Shit! Hey! Pull up, man! Come on, pull up!
Yes, I agree.
When we come back, he'll be gone.
There wasn't a lot of screaming in that one. What's going on with this compilation? Oh, yes. Classic scream from the movie. Or this is definitely one of the sequels. There's a lot of good screams in the Scream franchise.
Oh, shit.
What?
He's gone.
What?
All right. That was an okay scream. I feel like there's so many better screams. Like Neve Campbell, we could have found a better scream probably, as an example. But definitely, again, she was relying on the whistle tones, on the whistle harmonics.
And if you have a high voice, this is going to be easier for you to do. Part of why I hesitate to do these things and why I often go hoarse when I try to do these things is what's giving me my low voice is the three-dimensional density of my chords. So it's very, very hard for someone with a super low voice and very dense vocal folds to engage those sort of whistle harmonics. But if you wanted to start experimenting with, like, how would you get those whistle harmonics safely, I would look into some of the Fry screaming. I would learn some of the Fry screaming, because I think you could get whistle Fry harmonics. Or if you were a coloratura soprano, like a person who can actually sing whistle harmonics, which most people actually can't, so you have to have an extremely high voice. But if you can sing some whistle harmonics, like C6 and above, you can start with your whistle tones up there and kind of work on leaning them into sort of a pterodactyl squawk or into a Fry scream. And if you can really get a slightly less distorted Fry that's more whistle harmonics, kind of like a Danny Filth type of thing, I think you could navigate this type of screaming stuff if you were an actor. And I think a lot of the reason these people aren't permanently hoarse is because they're letting it flip into whistle tones. What we've heard is use of false chords in some cases and some harmonic whistle tones in some cases. And so I think that by doing either of those things, you can prevent a lot of like true fold slamming and hoarseness. But let's be honest, screaming has to sound real when it's in a live action movie. It can't be a suspension of disbelief unless you're playing a ghost or a character or something. So it's different than what we do in music. In music, we do not have to do very realistic sounding screams. And in fact, in music, a Fry scream sounds like a blood-curdling, realistic scream to the audience. Because it's music, it's not acting. It's an art. It has a different type of connotation to it. Like, acting is an art as well, but it's meant to be portrayed as like a real-life scenario. You're meant to believe it, you know? So music has that sort of suspension of disbelief where we're giving you a creation, but it's not necessarily acting. So let's keep checking it out and see what else they got.
They'd never make it in time.
Oh, this one's a classic.
Nowhere.
What do you want?
To see what your insides look like.
So that was another sort of false chordy one.
I'm calling the police.
That one had a lot of vestibular folds too. Wow, that was not at all her best scream. You know what? No offense to whoever made this, but there are so much better screams from these movies. So that was more just general true folds. That first ah, that could make you hoarse. That doesn't really rely on whistle tones. Oh, classic as well. Of course. Yeah, those are a lot of whistle harmonics here. Yeah, so those actually almost sounded similar to Fry screams with the whistle tone in it. There was another whistle tone one there for a second. So that's flipping between just true fold slamming and whistle tones. Many of these would make you hoarse.
No? I guess I just slept heavy. Okay. I'll see you. See ya. Doctor. Hi, everybody.
Believe this fog?
Oh, I believe anything is possible.
Bye.
Looking good, girl.
Hey!
That's not that good of a scream.
Hey, I'm not doing it.
Oh, we're gonna get some more here. Oh, look at Johnny Depp.
I'm not doing it.
What's going on with the window?
Mother! Mother! Mother!
Yeah, that was a pretty normal scream.
Hello?
Where's the scream? Give us the scream, boy. Yeah, I didn't hear like a lot of whistle tone screaming. A little bit there. Mostly true folds. Yeah, definitely. So, yeah, those were okay. I definitely think that. So let's go
this
over.
Just
gonna play some more stuff.
I found his face.
Sorry, hold on, gosh. I definitely feel like there are some pluses and minuses to doing movie type of acting screams. So if you guys want to get into some of that, do not. The worst thing you can do is just to actually try to scream out of nowhere. You probably will go hoarse. Just don't do that. Because, I mean, these are supposed to be realistic screams, but if you're an actor, you're going to try. You need your true folds. You can't be hoarse for the rest of the acting scenes. So you probably need to work on those, like, whistle tones or just being able to use some of your vestibulars and just kind of blowing past some of those, you know, work on some of the heavy metal screams first that are like safer phonations and then work backwards. And again, if you can get sort of this like flipping into whistle tones from like a high note, say you have a very high voice and you can sing whistle tones, but anybody can start to do it like, like squeaking over, kind of like squawking into it. You can probably get some whistle tones going. But if you're a person like me, where you have an extremely low voice, you may not really have much success doing whistle tones. I've taught a lot of folks to do whistle tones in my lessons, but I really am not any good at them. I have a very hard time getting them to happen at all. And it's because of the density of my chords. It's very hard to separate them. There's a few ways the whistle harmonics are being created. And a lot of it has to do with a slight light touching of the folds. And if you have real fat, dense folds, it's almost impossible to make them do that. So hello to everybody just joining us. I'm so excited to be here. Someone asked if they're a baritone with some thicker chords. A baritone, you'd be surprised. Sometimes baritone's folds are not as three-dimensionally dense as you'd think. So there are people with what I call four-octave ranges that I call wide-range baritones. These are guys like Devin Townsend, for example. So people who can sing all the way down to the D2, but he can also whistle fry. So there is the possibility that if you're a wider range baritone, then you can try to do it because I've seen that before. It's really just like the basses, or if you find that you're a baritone who like has a very like hard belt limit, like around G4 or A4, that might be just a normal baritone voice. It might be a little harder, but it's actually the length of the folds that are giving you your baritone voice, not necessarily the width. So I find that for male vocalists, it's really going to be like a bass or something before they can't do the whistle tones. So actually, yeah, you'd be surprised. If you go watch like some Devin Townsend range video type things, you'll hear some whistle fries, especially from back in the day when he was doing, you know, Strapping Young Lad and all that stuff. So I think you guys would find some examples there. I'm not sure what Danny Filth's like singing vocal range is, but he might be a baritone for all I know. He doesn't use his like voice very much, but he lives in the whistle harmonics, you know what I mean? And his speaking voice doesn't sound particularly high. So I think there are some good examples of some folks out there who are doing it. You know, again, you'd want to play with it and work on it. And for a male vocalist, I'm not sure, you know, again, how realistic. I guess if you're playing a character like Chris Tucker in Fifth Element, those kind of screams, he did a lot of really good whistle screams, actually. You know, it depends on what you're trying to get across. So, you know, I would just definitely figure it out. So the next question is, how do I figure out my vocal range? So the best way to figure out what your vocal range is to work on the lows first. People have very different low endings versus high endings. It'll take you years to max out your physical high. Oh, yeah. I forgot about the Steve Vai album. Yes, he did do crazy whistle tones on that album. Like, insane. And believe it or not, he's only like 19 or 20. So that'll make you a little bit envious. But back to the question from Lucas that said, how do I figure out my vocal range? Basically, when you're doing your vocal range, you want to work on the lows first. So like a baritone will be able to sing to like D2 or C2, a bass and a baritone. And like a tenor will only be able to sing to like A2, G2, maybe F2. You know, you'll have a very different low end. And most people can max that out. You know, counter tenor can only sing to like C3. So, you know, a good way to find out is I have all kinds of videos here on the channel of vocal exercises in the Belter series. And you can mess with those. I explain like when to come in and who should come in where. And you should try to see where your low end falls. That's basically how you're going to do it. You want to be singing like well beyond your speaking range and see how low you can go. You're going to try it with your highs, but the thing about the highs is it can take us years to get used to our physical limit of our high end. It takes a lot of technique and a lot of physical work. So, you know, you may not reach your physical max highs for a while. So you could have a high voice and like accidentally think you're a baritone because you're not singing very high at first. There will be a day you come to where you can't go any higher, like you've maxed out your physical limit, but that takes a long time to get to. So I would say look for your lows first. See where your low end is sitting. Most of us can get there pretty much within a couple of tries or a couple lessons, and you can really discover where you are. Then that will give you what's going to be a realistic goal to shoot for the highs, because there is a limit. It's a myth. You cannot just learn to sing as many octaves as you want. I wish we could. But we cannot. There are some noises we can learn to make, like whistle tones, but we can't all sing up there. So I want to, I'm going to make a quick adjustment here and see about, I want to make a quick adjustment to our chat box here, because I want it to stay up there while you guys are doing it. And I just wanted to, leave the messages up there because I think that would be cool. So, yeah. Anyway. All right, guys. So let's react to some more stuff. Oh, that's an interesting question. Someone says, should I consider, that's poor Chompy there. He's got, he's a wheezy old man. Want to go outside, buddy? There he goes. The chomp has left the building. I'm not sure what you mean by that, but the notes you're singing, whether they come from what you're hearing inside your head or what you're hearing outside of your head, are going to be the same. So whether you're a tenor or a baritone or a soprano, your note range is going to be the same inside your head or out of your head. If you are listening to your voice from inside your head, you know, what we just hear, nay, when you're sitting there singing by yourself, that is going to have a different tone, if you will, but it's not going to have a different vocal range. So it's still the same notes. You know what I mean? It's not going to be a different vocal range. It's going to be a different tone or timbre. We call it timbre. Someone says, I have maxed out at B5 and load out at G2. Yeah, so that's probably a tenor voice. If your max low is G2, you're really a tenor, not a baritone. And B5 is about where most tenors, this is pretty much my vocal range. G2 to B5, that's pretty much where I function. And then that can vary within a half step or a whole step on any given day. Every once in a blue moon, I can get a C6 or an F2. But pretty much G2 to B5 there is like a textbook, regular, normal, like Lane Staley tenor vocal range. So that means you could probably belt all the way up to C5 or D5 in your belt range. The B5 that he's talking about is going to be in the falsetto. This is talking about the full vocal range. And if you go down to gutturals, of course, you can produce subharmonics, just like our Fry whistle tones, that are beyond our actual physical vocal singing range. Subharmonics and superharmonics and whistle tones are things where extra harmonics we're creating with our voice or with noises we're making, but they're not necessarily something within their singing range. Like, I can create a lot of subharmonics in my harsh vocals that even as low as my voice is, are not at all possible in my singing range because of the physics of the chords. These are strings. They have a length and a width, and that's going to determine how far you can take the pitches that you sing. But with noises and other tones, we can definitely create phonations that create pitches beyond that. I only count people's vocal range as being what they can sing, not the harmonics they can generate. Okay, so... So for example, like I can create low harmonics by doing gutturals as well, and they're going to be way, way below anything I can sing. Something like, you can really hear like some of these deep, deep subharmonics in there, you know, that are way, way, a couple octaves below where I can actually sing with my voice, even though I can sing quite low. But these are noises I'm making, so they have subharmonics. So the next question is, I can do an F5 in falsetto, but only A4 in mixed. Okay, so I'm not sure what you mean by mix. So what different people are calling different things, I'm not entirely sure. I would say that if it's a tenor or a baritone, we should try to belt that A4. But if you're a baritone, that might be your last possible belt note, like a Dave Grohl or something. A baritone's belt range would go like D2 to G4 or A4. And then if you can go up to F5 in falsetto, that's also sounding pretty accurate, like a pretty textbook baritone vocal range. So, but there are physical maximums, you know what I mean? So even if you can belt the A4, if you're a baritone, that's probably the highest note you're going to be able to belt. Unless you're one of these sort of, again, wide range folks I was talking about. So, yeah. But anyway, this is going really great, you guys. I'm so stoked to be hanging out with you today. I want to get back to doing some more reactions and doing some more things. So I'm going to take a quick break here. And I'm going to be streaming for a few more hours with everybody today. And so we're going to go ahead and take a quick break, and I'll be back at about 2:00 my time. So at the top of the hour, it's 45, it's 15 till now, wherever you guys are. When I come back, we will get to doing some vocal recording and working on that and checking out how that goes. So thanks everybody, and I really appreciate you all, and thanks to anybody who has helped me with a little tip. Thank you very much. There is a link there below if you want to support the stream. I hope that you're all doing well today. Thanks for warming up with me, and we are going to take a look at vocal recording next, and then later this afternoon I'll tell you how you can get me to react to your vocals. So, all right. So, yeah, C6 in the falsetto is great, Emily. And that would be great, a tenor contralto max note, you know. That may vary, but a lot of folks can get up to that C6, and that's wonderful. That's fantastic. So, I'll be back in just a minute, everybody. Take a nice break. I'll see you at the top of the hour. Hello, 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 everybody. I'm back, and we're gonna do some fun stuff. We're gonna do some fun stuff. I'm gonna do some recording and teach you guys how to record while I do it, because why not? You know, this is gonna be fun. How many of you guys know how to record your own vocals? This is something that more and more people are learning how to do. But I definitely think that a lot of you guys still don't know how to do it, from what I can tell from my vocal clients and students. And I definitely feel like if I could show you guys a really useful skill, it would be recording. So I love it. I got a fever. And the only prescription is more voice acts. Dude, have you ever seen the second Wayne's World movie where Christopher Walken is in it? He's like my favorite part of that movie. He's genius. He's a genius. So here we are. Let me see. Actually, I haven't saved this. We got to save this. I got to save my project here on Reaper. Let's save it. Okay, I'm gonna, you guys can't see me here saving it, but I'm saving it because I don't want to lose it, right? I'm gonna start recording and I want to make sure that everything goes well. So, all right, that's my new project. Okay, so you guys I'm not sure I understand the question about background noise and ultra high sensitivity. You know, here's the thing. When you're recording vocals at home, you do not need a fancy setup. So you can see that this room here, you don't really see much foam going on here. On the side you guys can't see, there is a lot of foam. The side I'm facing, that the camera is on, so the side facing me. But you don't really need that. You can, microphones like this one, this is the Rode Procaster. This is the Pod Mic, excuse me. This is the Rode Pod Mic. The other ones I used are the Rode Procaster. And also there are not just the Rode Procaster, but there's the SM7B. There's a bunch of different microphones like that, dynamic microphones that actually don't need much. They're really directional. They're hyper directional, and they really don't need any. They have really good what we call like rejection. They don't need extra stuff on it. Normally I have this thing, but I loaned it to Carlos. Or actually, it's his. I shouldn't say that. It's his, and he lets me borrow it. I use this thing that you guys have seen in a lot of my videos, which is a Chaotica eyeball, it's called. And so it is like $150 or something like that, but it's super worth it. You don't, it costs a lot of money. Even just the amount of foam I have in here that you guys can't see, which obviously does not cover the room, was a couple hundred dollars. And it wasn't the most expensive foam. So I think the best thing for you guys to do is to use something like the Chaotica eyeball. And then when you're doing that, you can really, really isolate everything for a very low cost. It's a little bulb thing, and you put it over the microphone that you're using, and it also serves a double function as a pop filter. Microphones like this one, the Procaster, the SM7, Electro Voice RA20, all these type of microphones, these hyper-directional dynamic microphones, you don't really need a pop filter on them. They already have these screens on there. I will put an extra one because I'm just very heavy on the plosives all the time. But, you know, really what you do is just angle your microphone and you don't go right into, just don't go like right into it. And like over it like this is going to give you a much better, you won't have any problems really. So if you're using a microphone like this, you might not even need an extra, like the Chaotica eyeball or an extra pop filter. There's also these things you can get that kind of rotate around like this. Again, I think the eyeball is better than those, but they do exist as well. So, and of course, like, you don't want, you can't have like loud noises in the background. And you can't really be playing your music through the speakers. You got to be playing it through your headphones, stuff like that. You can't have extra noise going through here. But if your room is generally quiet and you have a pretty directional microphone, you don't have to worry. You're not going to get a lot of noise in there. You got to make sure you have good levels as well. A lot of white noise comes when things are turned down, turned like not loud enough. You're not, you don't have your gain up. You just get all this like fuzz in there. So make sure you've got your input levels all set really good and everything like that. You know, people are always asking me what I recommend for live, for studio. I wouldn't obsess over gear. I mean, I do recommend Rode mics for just about everything. But the thing is some of you guys that are new to vocals get way too obsessed over like what kind of mic you should have and if it's good enough and da 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 da. And especially live. Like live, everybody just uses an SM58. People don't use fancy things unless they get a nice wireless mic. So if you don't have a nice wireless mic, you want the SM58 or the SM58 beta pretty much for live. Rode has also a really good collection of handheld microphones for live as well. You know, and then studio, definitely the best bang for the buck on your microphone is the Rode stuff. The pod mic here and the Procaster are very, very reasonably priced and really, really outperform the cost. I really do. I genuinely switched to them because they were better than the other things I was using. So I definitely think Rode is the best bang for your buck as far as studio stuff goes, and the real quality of sound. And we're going to take a look at one of their kits in a little bit here. I've got a kit that came with an interface and a microphone, and that's kind of cool. You need an interface or a USB mic, but I recommend an interface because the interface will give you a headphone out and a microphone in. And by interface, I mean a little box that's separate from your computer that plugs into your computer through USB, and you plug the microphone into that. Good interfaces aren't that expensive, and we're going to take a look at this teeny tiny one that Rode makes. It just has one microphone input and one headphone output, and it's perfect. It'd be perfect for whatever you guys want to do, because you want to, like, a USB mic is not the same as having an interface, and having an interface, they're not particularly expensive. It performs better, etc. But don't obsess too much. If like all you can afford right now is a USB mic, you know, and then plugging your headphones into the computer, then that's what you're going to do. Because what I don't want my vocal clients and students and audience to be doing is making, like, just obsessing too much with gear, but never getting actually any singing done. You know what I'm saying? And, you know, with vocals, we don't have a lot of gear and it's not very high end. And you're going to use, like I said, live. I mean, even the most famous people, if they're not using a wireless, are using an SM58, you know, and that's just how it is. There's just these very simple standards. It's not very complicated. We don't buy like an ultra fancy mic to use live. You know, it's about your singing technique. The mic is going to pick up whatever, and it's not going to make very much difference, especially live where there's a lot of noise, you know, if your singing technique isn't any good. If you're not making good sounds to go through that mic, that's what you should be obsessing over, is what are the sounds you're making? Then even a cheap mic is going to sound better. You know what I mean? In the studio, you'll notice a difference, you know, but, and then someone else is asking, what do I use for live mic, amp, and speaker? Well, this kind of doesn't make sense, this question. I'm sorry, because the vocals live are amplified by the PA. Like whatever venue you go to, the PA, the public address system, that's what it's called, but that's the speaker system and the venue for those of you that are new, and you might have one in your band's rehearsal space. So the overall speakers that you see the sound coming out of to the audience from the stage, that is what your vocals come through. We do not buy amps as vocalists. We don't, you know, we don't buy, we don't need to carry cabinets or amps. Even a lot of guitar players don't do that anymore because they use digital processors. But So yeah, so you just, if you would just bring your microphone to a show or rehearsal, you know, the band or the rehearsal space needs to own a PA for you to go through. And if you're practicing with a band, you know, you want to probably look for a rehearsal space that has a PA already. So you can just use theirs. You know, you rent a rehearsal space where they have a PA in it. There, I live in Las Vegas, so it's a lot easier here than it is most other places. There are several places here you can rent hourly to rehearse, and there's already a PA in there. So you run your vocals through the PA, and the band can also run through the PA, etc. And so there are the things on the floor at the front of the stage that face you. Those are monitors. Those are going to send the vocals back to you so you can hear yourself on stage. So there are speakers in the PA that face the audience and speakers in the PA that face you. It's all the same PA speaker system. Yeah, so in your home, you also wouldn't use a PA. You would use the computer, you know, to practice with. There's no like home microphone amp unless you would do. These are great questions, by the way, guys. Be nice. Don't tease folks, because everybody has to be new at some point. And one of the goals of the Voice Hacks channel is, though I am very experienced, I was a noob at one point and had many of the same questions. And I find that there is this barrier in a lot of tech streaming and tech and subjects and music stuff where it's like, you either have to be phenomenal or there's no place for you to start. So beginners are welcome, and all your questions, no matter how silly they might seem, are welcome. So even though I'm very direct with my answers, I'm not looking down at all at you guys, and you guys in the chat, just be kind to each other, because everybody has to be new before they can get good at something. How can you become good at something without, everyone has a first day at their job. Everyone has a first try at something. But I did, to be fair, I also have gone out of my way to educate myself. Nowadays, I mean, I took recording classes and things in college, but you guys can just find many of these things on the internet. If you're really interested in learning how to record, there are millions and millions of free tutorials. But there are also, you know, there's folks like me here streaming, but then there are also places like the Unstoppable Recording Machine Academy and the Nail the Mix, where you can really learn how to record and everything. But that's different from being a vocalist and needing to practice at home. So if you're practicing at home with your vocals, you should not probably be running speakers or a PA or anything like that, unless you want to own one for some other reason. And then, because the thing is, it's going to be loud and you're going to bother your neighbors. Like, you know, if you have like a garage or something, you can put your PA out there if you want. You could do that. I mean, there are like these karaoke machines. I have one of those. The Singing Machine gave me one because they made one for vocalists, which was really cool. But it is like a mini PA, and it's not at all how most of us practice. Most like professional level vocalists, or even just basic working vocalists, are doing kind of what I'm doing now. They have their interface. They actually practice through the computer, and you have your headphones on and you run your microphone through the computer. This could be the same microphone you use live. This is just a regular microphone cable. You could just switch it out and put your handheld microphone. And then what you want to do is use audio software like what you see in the background here. This is Reaper, this audio software back here. And you want to see that, and you want to use that and run your vocals through here. You can actually listen to yourself through Reaper. So if I hit this, or any audio software, they call audio software for recording a digital audio workstation, a DAW. So everybody picks their own DAW. There are several DAWs available. There's Pro Tools, there's GarageBand, there's Logic, there's several different audio, there's Cubase, there's PreSonus, and there's Reaper. The reason I use Reaper is I switched to it after using Pro Tools for about 20 years, actually. But I actually love it. It is a program you can use for free. I have the paid version, but you can put it in evaluation mode forever. You can use it for free. And there are free tutorials on it. So, and it's an extremely powerful DAW, and it works as good, just as good, and if not better than some of, many of the other DAWs that I've tried. I tried out a bunch of them actually before I switched, because I knew I was getting to the point where I wanted to switch out of Pro Tools to something else. And it's just very modern DAW, very up to date, very lightweight. Even if you have a really crappy computer, it's probably going to run pretty decently. I've been able to run a lot of tracks even on my old computer, which was kind of slow. So I highly recommend it. I love the way it works and everything like that. So whatever audio software you have, though, they're all going to like function and look approximately the same. So these are my audio tracks here. This one's going to be for my vocals. And you can hear when I click that record button, there's more voice in here because I'm monitoring myself now. So this is letting me hear like what's coming back. When I take that off, it stops monitoring it. And this also arms it for recording. If I hit record and this is not on, nothing's going to record on either of these tracks. So it's coming from here through my interface. And I've said here where it's coming from. So it knows where to pull it from my interface. And that's it. And then I can hear myself. We'll call this vocals. All right, let's see. So good question is, do I not run? So if I'm monitoring at home and I'm practicing like this, I am going to run some compressors and some things on the channel strip here. So you're going to put in, for me, I love to use like bus glue. The Joel Wanasek bus glue. Where the hell is it? Oh, I gotta clear that. Okay. It's just BG. And I'm gonna put this on here. This is a an amazing compressor. Hey. Ha ha ha. Oh, I gotta arm it. Hey. Check. Oh, I put it on the wrong one. Wrong track. Okay, so, oh, you guys can't see this. Let me fix that. Why can't it let you see where I'm putting the plugins? Well, let me just add it and you'll be able to hear it. Hey. Whoa, different. That is my compressor. Sounds really, really hot now. Let me disarm that because that's loud as hell. Live, the engineer, you know, you're going to show up to the venue, and most of you guys that are new are not going to run your own sound. And you're just going to have your sound go through the PA, and the sound guy is going to be in charge of your sound. And they are going to run compression and reverb on it to their taste live. All sound guys are going to do that. You know, they are going to put something on it, some EQ, some compression, some reverb, and everything like that. So I would be aware that the engineer is going to add some stuff. So you typically don't have any control over that. Now, that being said, I have a band that I put together in town here where we do some covers, and we have to run tracks live, which actually means we have to run, because there's a lot of synthesizer tracks, and it's easier than having another player. And we have all the synths programmed, which means we need to play along to a click track and all the programmed synths, and they're going to be running out of a computer. And because of that, I can run my vocals through the computer and then back out and control my own compression and reverb. And you could, I have seen vocalists bring occasionally, maybe like 3 times in the last 15 years, bring their own rack of gear. So you could buy like rack equipment, just like a guitar player, and bring your own compression and reverb and stuff. But if you have a fast computer and you're running it live, you can run it through the DAW. It probably won't. The computers are fast enough now that if you have the right gear, it's probably not going to be latent. And so you could run some really great plugins live if you want to, but that's way more advanced. So for right now, you would just show up to the venue with your regular old microphone, and the whoever the sound guy is going to throw some compression and reverb on it. And that's how I've been doing it the majority of my life, because I haven't always been performing at this time where computers are super fast and you can do all your own stuff. So, you know, that's how it was for years. And I never had a rack of gear or anything. So if you really want to hear yourself good on stage, you want to use in-ear monitors, which are like headphones that you have connected to a wireless pack. Okay. And then you can hear what the guy's doing to your vocals and all that cool stuff. You can hear it through the floor monitors too, which also I've used the majority of my career, you know, and you'll hear it there too. So, and then you can tell them how much you want to hear. Like, I want to hear more of my vocals. I want to hear less of my guitar. That's what you're communicating with the sound guy for. They're in charge of your monitor mixes, what you're hearing, and also in charge of what the audience is hearing, which are two different things. You have a different monitor mix on stage than what's coming out of the PA to the audience. So you could have just vocals and bass in your monitor, for example. So it's not all that complicated, though. Keep it simple. At first, just buy very simple microphones, practice through a DAW at home, and you know, try to rent rehearsal spaces when you get together with the band that have a PA. If you really want to make your own noise at home, you can get small PAs like Fender's all-in-one kit or a karaoke machine. But I don't think that's a great idea. I think practicing through your headphones through the DAW is way easier and way more efficient, and you can hear yourself a lot better, and you can actually control your own mixes and things. And all that jazz. Although I do have to say that the singing machine, karaoke machine that they gave me, and if you want to check that out, the videos in my YouTube channel, was pretty great. You could play music through it and listen to your headphones and listen to yourself through it and not turn the speaker on if you wanted. But it was like an advanced karaoke machine that was meant for musicians. So you could check that out. I forgot what it was called, the singing machine something, but it's in my YouTube videos from a couple years ago. And you guys can look at that as well. So right now we're looking at home recording. So we've got our DAW. So you open up your digital workstation. And I want to go back earlier to someone who said, what if I just have iPhone and GarageBand? Well, I really don't think using a DAW on a tablet or a phone is a good idea. They don't run the same. It's not the same version of the software, especially GarageBand. It's totally different. And it's really not meant to do, they're meant to do like mobile recordings of more like stereo things. It's very difficult to do proper multi-track recording on a DAW. And I would not do it on a tablet or a phone. Okay, guys, you really need a computer. And that's why I like Reaper, though. And GarageBand is great on a computer, too. Either one of them are really lightweight programs that will function really, really powerfully. And there are lots and lots, especially for Reaper, of tutorials. You guys have to be resourceful. I mean, that's why you're here. You're listening to me. You're being resourceful. But realize, like, nobody walked up to me and just gave me, like, all this information, you know? I had to go out and seek it out. And I realize that's what you're here doing. But beyond me, seek this stuff out. Look up Reaper tutorials and things. Reaper's free. You can download it, and you can learn a DAW for free. But I actually like it. I bought the paid version, so I don't care if it's free. I don't think there's a lot of difference between the paid and the free version. I just liked it and wanted to support. It was still only like $60 or something. But the point is that when you're doing this stuff, you want to look up tutorials. There are basic tutorials. Watch people do stuff with it. You know, I know you're here watching me do it, but the point is be resourceful. You have so many more resources than I had. And just getting in there and using it, forcing yourself to use it is how you learn. That's how I learned, was like forcing myself to record. And you make mistakes, you know, but you're going to learn what to do and not to do. So in this case, I've set up the session. So when you open the session, it's usually blank. And you can double click here and add tracks. And then you can also delete the tracks
and whatnot. And you can change the color of the track. I'm gonna change the color because I like special color tracks. That's pretty. Yeah, let's make it purple because I like purple a lot. Okay, there we go. Purple track for vocals. Why not? You can see whichever one you're highlighting and selecting the track. This is an important thing, like in GarageBand, because whichever selected track you have selected, you know, you're going to have options and things you can do with it in the menu and stuff. So it doesn't have to be selected, by the way, to record, as long as you arm it. Whoa, that's how it sounds like with my compressor. Whoa. So as long as you arm it to record, it doesn't actually have to be selected. This is the timeline. It's going from left to right. You can display this in bars or in time. I prefer it in time because there's different reasons you may want to do that, but I don't actually know the official tempo of the song, and I don't really care if I have the click for it. I'm just going to record with it. So these are layers, and it's not like Photoshop where if I bring this layer up, it becomes louder or something like that. So they're not like visual layers like in video or photo software, okay, or imaging editing. In those cases, you're determining like what is on top and what's on the bottom and what people can see and what they can't see. And same thing with streaming software, it's like that too. It's like what is visible to some folks and what isn't. And in this case, the order of them doesn't have any difference. Doesn't do anything to the mix if I put one on top of the other. And so this is what we call the edit window. Down here is what we call the mix window. These look like the channel strips, and you can control like the volume of each of the individual tracks down here. And that's the volume, you know, relative to each other. That's like the basic where you start doing your basic mixing. And so in this case, I'm working on a collab with another YouTuber, and her name is Mara Lysenko. I don't know if you guys know Mara. Anybody subscribe to Mara's channel, Mara Lysenko? She is also a harsh vocalist. I'll write this down here. And she's really great and has a few different tutorials and things out there. But she is super awesome, and we're going to do this collab together on a Chimera song. And we are doing harsh vocals, each of us. So we are going to do two different parts. We're doing this Chimera song called Pure Hatred. And we've divided it up into different sections, and I'm going to start recording the harsh vocals for that. And so let us take a look here. And I want to adjust one of my stream settings. I might have to like pause the stream to do that. I don't know. I don't know if I can pause it and adjust it. I don't think I can without coming back. But let's do it anyway. I hope it's not too weird for you guys. Let's go ahead. And so I'm going to do some recording here. And basically, I want to fry scream on the song. This song is all harsh vocals. I'm not sure if you guys are familiar with the song Pure Hatred by Chimera. But this instrumental, I had someone make. So another question I get a lot in lessons is, okay, where can I get the instrumental without the vocals? Because in a stereo recording, you don't have access to the individual tracks like what you're seeing here. Only the original engineer has those. So to get the accompaniment, you have to make one a lot of the times. Sometimes it's a famous enough band that there is a karaoke accompaniment available. Or there's been some people who did some instrumental covers. But in the case of this particular song, I had my friend make the accompaniment.
And he's a guy that does a lot of mixing for me. His company's called Matt Black Audio, and he's really cool. And his name's Colin, and he made this accompaniment for me. So, you know, you either have to pay someone to make you an accompaniment. There's not a lot of ways to delete the vocals out of an accompaniment and have it sound good. It's usually not that great sounding. So I would try to, you can even go on Fiverr and find folks who will make you something. But yeah, so here we go. Let's hear the accompaniment a little bit. So you can see there's no vocals on this. But I know where they come in, so. we have decided to split the vocals, and we talked about where we're going to do which vocals. So I'm going to do the first verse, and she's going to do the second verse. So I'm going to record those vocals first, the first verse here. And let me just get that going for us. So let us try. Let's see here. I'm super thirsty. Zzz! I haven't done any screaming yet today. So I want to fry scream for this because that's pretty much what I feel like Mark Hunter did. I don't know if you guys were influenced by Chimera, but I was heavily influenced by Chimera. And I actually couldn't fry scream when they were around. I could only false chord scream. And now that I can fry scream, I want to do it fry scream. So there's no question about that in my mind. But I definitely was inspired by Mark Hunter and all the Chimera DVDs from back in the day. They had a lot of DVDs, you know, before you guys being so lucky. You could just watch like the Parkway Drive documentary on YouTube here if you want to or whatever. But before bands had like a lot of social media, made a lot of content, you know, we relied on these like DVDs that came with the CDs or that were like a bonus to the CD. And Chimera was one of them. And they always had the most badass DVDs about their production. And I actually got to work with one of the guys that produced a lot of their stuff, Jason Sukoff, from one of my albums with Luna Mortis, after seeing all those DVDs, which was really cool because it was pretty legendary to get to go to work with him and everything. So yes, let us go back and let's do some frying. Yeah! All right, I think I'll be all right. So let's fry. Let me just get my little lyrics going here. I'm probably going to have to sit up for this. But let's just see how this goes. When I first do this, it's a very long intro. I'm going to fast forward, and I'm not going to start at the very beginning. And then it's going to record going across as I do the vocals. And I can keep them. I can delete them. First time through, I'm probably not going to like it. So, but with harsh vocals, you definitely don't have to do as many takes as you need to do with clean vocals because it's just... with harsh vocals, they're not like singing in tune or anything like that. So let's hear. Okay, so it's also going to be kind of loud for you guys because I have the compressor on now. So I would normally put some reverb on it, but the reverb that I like using, I don't think I moved to this computer, which sucked. I lost a few plugins when I switched my computer, and I haven't exactly finished fixing them yet. So I don't know. Let's try this one. Hello? Hello? I don't like that one. Hello, hello, hello. Hello. Hi. Ooh, that's good. It's a little bit... Let's just, like, de-wetten that a little bit. Okay, hello. So I just changed, like, the ratio of reverb to voice a little bit so that it wasn't, like, so enormous. Hey! Yeah! But I definitely don't want it totally dry. Oh, where did it go? I feel like I lost... Hello? Hey? There it is. And maybe a little bit. Hey? There we go. All right. Yeah! There we go. So this channel has compression and reverb. And what's cool about recording in the DAW is... oh, thank you so much, Spawn Killer. Everybody give him a high five for the super chat. So I really appreciate it. If you guys feel like you want to support the stream, there are tip links below, but on YouTube, you can just use the super chat in the chat to do it. So Danke, everybody. Thank you. You know, it's just for showing your appreciation for the stream. A lot of this stuff is stuff I would teach in lessons. This is me spending hours with you guys that I would normally charge people a lot for lessons. So, and if you are interested in vocal lessons with me, I should put the link below as well. Let me just put it in the chat for vocal lessons. Vended Asylum. Who's Vended Asylum? I don't know who that is. Oh, you mean the song Vended, the band Vended. I've heard of the band Vended. I have not checked out their song Asylum. They are doing really good, though. I think they were, like, playing one of the festivals, the Knot Fests or something. I don't know. But, yeah, I haven't really checked them out yet, though. So for lessons, anybody who's interested in lessons... I'll put it down here so you can in the chat window. It takes a second. I'm terrible at typing and talking at the same time. And you can, it's a self-serve booking portal. So if you're interested in vocal lessons on clean or harsh vocals, just click on that and you can, join me there. So, oh, I don't know why. This is, does it keep saying offline for you guys, even though I'm back in here, like this Reaper session? Oh, well, hopefully you can see me record. Anyway. Okay, so that's about where the vocals are going to come in right there. Let's delete that. And let's go back here. Oh no. Oh, I see. It goes back to being online when I'm in here. Okay, cool. Let me hear this. I'm gonna test out my levels. Yeah! I have told you things need to change! Okay. I think that's gonna be good for me. So I'm going to throw out all that because I was just checking my levels, basically. So let's try to scream now and actually get some actual check takes. Here we go. Yeah! Oh yeah, nope, we can't keep that. So you guys can see that my gain was way too high. We gotta turn that down. So I gotta turn my mic, the actual input volume from my mic down, because that was way too loud. Check, check, but I'm turning the level up. Thank you.
in charge. You never listen or care to my eyes. This vicious cycle has no church.
Holy shit. Whew. Okay, so that's really hard. So I realized that I probably don't want to track that all at once. Because that is a fast phrase and I'm going to run out of air. So what I would usually do with something that fast, I like that opening scream. I might keep that. Let's hear what that sounded like. Not bad. I can probably do that one better. So what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to duplicate this track. And this is going to duplicate to... oh, thank you so much. French fry screaming. That's when you fry in French. My friend Sebastian Croteau from the Monsters Factory can tell you all about that. He's French. He's French-Canadian. So it's different, but you can fry scream in French, I think. That would be cool. Thank you so much to Theandric for your super chat. I really appreciate it. Thank you, guys. And just remember, little tips are just because this is a lot of my time, and I really want to help you guys. My whole mission is just to help people, and it just helps me, when you're showing me your appreciation and everything like that, and make up for some of the time that I'm spending with you guys. A lot of times I would be doing lessons for folks, you know. So, yes. All right. Let's take a look at some screams again. So, both of these now have my effects on them, my compression and my reverb. So, what I'm going to do is I'm going to record the yaw and the first sentence. And then I'm going to go to the second track and record the second sentence and then go back to the first track because I want an accurate recording. We don't record all the way through, and because it doesn't actually sound very good. You want an accurate recording. When you perform live, you're going to do it all the way through. But when you're doing a pre-recorded thing, you want to do it section by section and get the best take per section. And that's how all the most professional engineers are going to have you do it as well. So try it again.
Yeah! I am soldier with legs need to charge.
Okay, so that's the first sentence. And let's just hear how that sounded.
Yeah!
Yeah, okay, I like that. I'll keep that. And then we're going to go to the second track here. So we disarm this one, and now we're going to record on this track, and I'm going to record the second verse. And I'm doing this on different tracks because when it's this close together, there might be some tail overlap between sentences. And that's okay. That will sound good on a pre-produced recording like this. Because with this, you know, you record the vocals in advance and then you make your video afterwards. It's like making a music video. This is how most YouTube collabs are done. This is how I'm doing the collab with Mara. We're recording our parts ahead of time. Then we film the video and put it together afterwards. So let's see about the second sentence. Here we go. We call this like punching in, essentially. A lot of times you can punch in on the same line, but when it's like real close together like this, you kind of want two different tracks so that just in case it overlaps at the end, it's not an awkward editing scenario later. So.
Yeah! I am soldier. lesson who came to my aid.
Yeah. I feel like I wasn't ready. Let me do that again.
I have told you things need to change. You never listen who came to my aid.
Not too bad. Let's hear it all together.
I have told you things need to change. You never listen who came to my aid.
Not bad. So you can see if I zoom in here, there's kind of an overlap right here. And it doesn't really sound like that when it's mixed, but it is.
I have told you things need to change. You never listen who came to my aid.
It'll sound tighter in the mix because you kind of like fade that one out as this one comes in. So I think that sounds pretty good. If I hate it later, I can just re-record it, you know. You can see how it's kind of fast. Now that I've been doing harsh vocals for a number of years, once you can do them really well, like if it's not, again, clean singing, it doesn't have like a lot of pitch in it, a lot of like, is this in tune or whatever, you know, you can do it in just a few takes. My clean singing, trust me, anything with singing in it is gonna take me a lot longer. So just realize that. Let me go to the next one here. So I'm gonna go back to this track here. This song is all just like in your face. By the way, this song's called Pure Hatred by Chimera, if you guys don't know it already. If you're kind of younger and you don't know Chimera, you are missing out, man. They were super good.
I have told you things need to change. You never listened who came to my aid. This is my goal, has not changed.
Ugh. I think, so I might do a little, you know, before I get to it, like, you'll see it on the thing, but I'm not going to keep it. It's just going to prepare me before I get ready for the punch.
I have told you things need to change. You never listened who came to my aid.
Wait, hold on.
I have told you things need to change. You never listened who came to my aid. The vicious cycle has not changed.
Not too shabby. Let's hear it.
The vicious cycle has not changed.
I don't know.
Who came to my aid. The vicious cycle has not changed.
The tone is good, but like the words vicious, I can't understand it. And a lot of times that's going to be the case with your harsh vocals. You can't understand them. I mean, this is harsh vocals, but, you know, I feel like I could get a little more articulation even as hard as the song is. So let me just try that.
I have told you things need to change. You never listened who came to my aid. The vicious cycle has not changed.
I think that'll do for now. That'll do. Let's see what else. Thanks to everybody who's just joining us. It's so great to have you all here. You're on the Voice Hacks channel. We are doing some vocal recording. I'm doing some recording for a cover collab I'm going to be doing with my fellow YouTuber, Mara Lysenko. She's freaking awesome. So if you guys haven't checked her channel out, please do. I got to do one more sentence for my section. We've divided the song into different sections that we're each going to do.
My voice been rearranged. My voice been rearranged. My voice been rearranged.
I like that. I actually feel like I need to redo this one because I feel like I'm holding on a little bit too long. So you don't want it to overlap too much. We'll try that.
I have told you things need to change. You never listened who came to.
Oh shit. I was recording on the wrong track. Goop. That's what Apple Z is for. Undo.
I have told you things need to change. You never listen or came to my eyes. This is a cycle last on time. My size been rearranged. This is a cycle last on time. My size been rearranged. This is a cycle last on time. My size been rearranged.
Yeah, it's these. So, just to go back to, you guys know that I have reverb and compression on the channel. When I disarm that, you can't hear it anymore. But, and if I turn these off, it's not on my vocals, by the way. So, what you have on the channel is not permanently going on your recording. And that's a good thing, because you want to be able to send raw vocal tracks to whoever you mix it to without any of those effects on them. They're going to put them on there, but not... You don't want to send it with them on there. You can if you leave it turned on, but if I turn them off, they'll just be dry. They won't have any of that on there. Oh, it made them really quiet because my compressor makes it really loud. So here we go.
I have told you things need to change. You never listen or came to my eyes.
So that's just them raw, if you know. I'm gonna go ahead and turn them back on, though.
I have told you things need to change. You never listened or came to my eyes. This is like a last on time. My size been rearranged.
I think I'm actually still holding changed too long. Let's just do it again. And try it.
I have told you things need to change. You never listened or came to my eyes. This is like the last on change. My size been rearranged.
Shit.
This is like the last on change. My size been rearranged.
That might work.
This is like the last on change. My size been rearranged.
Well, there's something weird at the end there. Let me do it again.
I have told you things need to change. You never listened or came to my eyes. This is a cycle has not changed. My size been rearranged. This is a cycle has not changed. My size been rearranged.
Yeah, I think that would work.
This is a cycle has not...
What am I saying there? Oh my god. You guys see why this is faster, like I said, than recording clean singing, but you got to do a lot of takes. We did not talk yet about reacting to viewer vocals, and we're going to do that a little bit later today. So me reacting to your vocals, it's basically going to be, let me turn off this reverb quick. It's basically going to be where I set up this thing, this special chat thing, and where you guys are able to send me media, and you do that through this special chat link, and I'll give that to you guys a little bit later. I don't have it on yet because I didn't want to start yet, and basically then I'll be able to react to your songs, but it has to be somewhere like a link on YouTube or something where you can send it to me through the chat. So we'll get to that a little while, but that is not on the docket until a little later today in the stream. So we're going to do this recording a little bit longer here, and then we will get to reacting to your vocals later today, which is really cool. So let me just keep going here with this recording. So I'm gonna punch in this part again. I'm being a perfectionist here. It's hard to say. The words are, this vicious cycle has not changed, and it's really fast. It's really hard to say, and I'm getting really dried out. So let's do this.
I have told you things need to change. You never listened or came to my eyes. This is a cycle has not changed. My size been rearranged.
Okay, let's see how that goes.
This is a cycle has not changed. My size been
rearranged. Not bad. I might be pretty happy with that one. And you can see I'm cutting off all this stuff at the beginning here. You know, it's like a word processor. You can delete and cut out and edit these things. copy and paste, just like a word processor. Whoops, that one I moved and I didn't want to move it. I'm trying to get rid of like this empty space where there's no vocals. That gets rid of a lot of the noise as well. So you know, if you hit your desk or whatever, you want to delete like all that stuff in between, make it really nice and clean.
Yeah! I have told you things need to change. You never listened or came to my aid.
This is a cycle.
Has not changed. My thoughts been rearranged.
Like words that start with re.
Re.
That was pretty cool. So then the next part, the next sentence, if you guys know the song, is where he's like, motherfuck it all. That's going to be Mara. So because we're alternating sections. So I'm going to actually leave that blank because I will wait for her vocal files to throw in here. And I will create new tracks. When she sends me those vocal files, it'll just be the vocals. They'll be able to just slip right into this session as new tracks. And I will put them in right where they're supposed to go. So we're going to do the chorus together, which the song is called Pure Hatred. The chorus is just, I hate everyone. So kind of universal, hate everyone. So there's nothing, nobody specific here, just everyone. But I think like this is a song that's very cathartic in 2021. It's just like you just hate everything and everyone because, I don't know, it's just so... been such a frustrating couple years with the pandemic and everything. So that's another verse. So let me go back to. That's where it comes in. So let's start here. And I'm going to start back on this track again. Here we go. And this is a slower tempo. So I'm probably not going to have to punch in on different tracks.
I hate everyone! I hate everyone!
I think I'm probably just gonna keep that. Not a hard part. Also, guys, I've practiced fry screaming for years, and I practice it every day with my students when I'm teaching them. And multiple times a week, you know, and I practice at rehearsals and all kinds of stuff. So making it like easy, but first of all, there's a lot of physical effort taking place here and also a lot of years of work behind that.
I hate everyone! I hate everyone!
Yeah, we're going to keep that. We're gonna go ahead and keep that. We're going to get to keep that. Well, you know, someone's asking, they said, I still don't know how you do this. It's they've been trying for a long time, but I mean, it's taken me years as well. It's not like I woke up doing these things one day. And before I ever got my first scream out, I got to tell you guys that I was a trained classical vocalist first. So, and I had already been singing in musicals and theater for like 10 years before I even got to college and started formal classical training. So I had like years and years and years of singing practice and training before I even ever first got my first scream out. And these screams were not my first screams. My first screams were false chord screams. So if you're a noob, I would start with the false chord scream. The fry scream can take years, literally years. I'm just very fortunate that I'm years into it at this point. You know what I mean? But you just got to start screaming. You got to start doing something. So try the false chord scream or try voice with distortion and get good at that. Just get good at one thing. I started with false chord and I only did false chord for years. You know, I didn't even care that much about frying. I was pretty happy with it. It started happening to me on accident about 7 or 8 years ago. And then I started refining it through lesson teaching people and stuff. So I just really want you guys to understand that this is not natural for me either. And if you want to learn harsh vocals and do them safely and well and this quickly and everything, it's a lot of work. It is really, really a lot of work.
We'll take a minute and answer a couple questions here. So one question said, do you have a rest day in your week? Yeah, I teach like every day almost, but there are a couple of days a week I don't teach, but I also try to put breaks in between my lessons if I can, and I don't do a lot of talking outside of that. So today, this is a lot of talking for me to be streaming this long. So this is a little bit hard on my voice, but I will have not very many people for lessons tomorrow, and then that way I can kind of rest my voice tomorrow. So, you know, you've got to balance. It does take a lot of balance between work and rest. Yeah, this is interesting. Someone's Machine Wright said that they tried false cord and then it helped them discover Fry. And that's kind of what's happened to me as well. So I would say take the pressure off and learn something like false cord and just enjoy it and be good at it for a while. And it will lead you and open the door into a lot of other harsh vocals. And don't forget, a lot of very famous, very successful people are only doing the false cord scream. So it's not like you need the Fry scream to be putting out records. I had records out and record labels with only the false chord scream, and it was great. So just kind of realize, like, that is good enough, you know? Someone alone in my mind also asked, does the glottal stop mess your voice up? And glottal stops are these sounds like A, A, E, I, oh, and it's actually a huge myth that that messes up your voice. It does not. It isn't particularly aesthetic. You know, in a lot of classical singing, they don't want you to do that. But in speaking, we do them all day, every day. Every word that starts with a vowel in pretty much any language. Some languages are more glottal heavy. Some accents are more glottal heavy than others. And certainly no one's going hoarse from speaking a glottal heavy language like Finnish or Arabic or something. And we're doing it all day long. I opened all of our applesauce. I mean, every word that starts with a vowel, when I just said I mean and every, it just did it. We have lots of glottal stops. Glottal stops are just closing the chords before you speak. So they sound pretty ugly, especially if you do them hard, like, you know, doesn't really feel very good, but it doesn't slam the folds, just to be clear. It's shedding the chords right before you speak, and it creates a little air pressure behind them, and then they burst open, and that's kind of like what makes the popping sound. But they're actually used in speech therapy. Speech therapists have been known to give out like sheets of glottals, words that start with glottals, to people who need to strengthen their chord closure muscles. And they'll just have them read them to strengthen them. Apple, eat, open, area, you know. So you've got to just really, this is a myth, you know. I wouldn't like, what's the danger with glottals is the same danger as Fry. It's a bit of a misunderstood danger. Neither one is going to make you hoarse if you're doing it properly. But the danger with anything that closes the chords or compresses the chords or lots and lots of glottals is just fatigue and getting tired. And when we get tired or overworked, we can create tension. We can get tension dysphonia. We can get all kinds of things. When the chords get tired, that's when they typically start malfunctioning, even if you have really good technique. So really any sounds that make your muscles work really hard, that like glottal stops or Fry screaming like what I'm doing here, it's going to fatigue your chords and fatigue the muscles without making them hoarse. But fatigued chords can start to make you hoarse because they can start to do things wrong. They're not holding the position correctly anymore, and there's a lot of problems. So just kind of be aware of that. Like, your vocal folds can get fatigued from a lot of like closure action. And some people can scream on a glottal stop like that. I think the one best example I have on screaming on a glottal stop is the guy from At the Gates, Thomas Lindbergh. He's really good at like, ow, you know. A glottal stop isn't so hard to do on a Fry scream because you're closing the chords. So, ow, ah, you know, it's not that difficult. It's a compressed chord sound. So it is difficult in the other sounds. And of course, if anything feels like painful, you know, please don't do it.
just use your best instincts. And if you go hoarse at all, then really don't do it. You know, something is wrong then. So you can see I've been screaming, but I'm speaking to you. I'm not hoarse. So let's keep going. The next part of the song. So is she does the opening part of the next section. And then the second half is basically structured the same. And so I'll do the second half of the verse for the next section. Didn't know where the frick the second half of the verse started. So last question was, do you warm up before you scream? Oh, definitely. We did warm ups earlier on the stream, the very beginning of the stream. Do vocal warm ups, guys. Do not skip them. Even if you know it, don't know what you're doing, it's going to save you a lot. This is like trying to lift weights. It's like a lot of muscle stuff. And if you do it without stretching, you're just going to pull stuff, you know, like save yourself some trouble. Warm up. Use the Belter series warm ups on my channel here. They're great and they'll get you warmed up even for screaming. They're regular clean singing warm ups, but they'll work just fine as well. So try them out. Let's go ahead and let me record this part here.
You fucked it up with your motherfucking games. Remember when I said I was so ashamed? Well, nothing has changed.
I think I fucked all that up. Ironically, my first words are, you fucked it up. So there's this other part where at the end of this sentence, Mark Hunter originally went like, well, nothing has changed. So I'm not going to fry that, and I'll probably track that on the second track here. So let's do this again.
You fucked it up with your motherfucking girls. Remember when I said I was so ashamed?
That might work. Let's just...
You fucked it up with your motherfucking curves. Remember when I said I was so ashamed?
Yeah.
You fucked it up with your motherfucking curves. Remember when I said I was...
Let me just hear that.
You fucked it up!
I'm not sure if I like that. Let me, whoops. Let's redo that. I like the rest of it. I didn't know if I liked that intro. Here we go.
You fucked it up with your motherfucking...
Let's see.
You fucked it up with...
I feel like it's a little late, so I'm actually going to move it.
You fucked it up!
When I moved it, sounds better. So if you're like a little late or something, you can just do that instead of redoing the whole take.
You fucked it up with your motherfucking curves. Remember what I said? I was so...
All right, so now I'm going to go down here and do the last part where he goes, well, nothing has changed. And I'm going to do it like that. This is a different thing that we call like vocal fry. It's not the fry scream. It's a gurgly sound. It's different. So here we go.
Remember when I said I was so ashamed?
Well, nothing has changed. Let's see.
Well, nothing has changed.
I don't know if I like the expression on that.
Remember when I said I was so ashamed?
Well, nothing has changed. I kind of liked my low voice better than gurgling.
Well, nothing has changed.
Let me do that again.
Well, nothing has changed. Well, nothing has changed.
Yeah, I don't mind that. I think later that might have to go on a separate track to get mixed differently, but that's no big deal. You just make one and you drag it into it. So, that's great. So, then there's a bunch of stuff. Then it just does the I hate everyone chorus again. And then there's a bunch of stuff that we're going to do at the end that are these repeated, I hate everyone. The kind of we have to get kind of creative with that. We haven't exactly decided what we're going to do, but I think I'm going to keep all these. So thanks, guys. So that's my little insight into recording for today. And that's my project with Mara. If you're finding the stream useful at all to you, or you're learning anything, feel free to leave me a little tip in the jar, and you can do that using the super chat here on YouTube. Otherwise, there is a link in the description as well, directly to the tip button. So thank you all very much for supporting the channel and for supporting what I do here. If you feel like you're getting good information out of it and everything like that. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to take a little break, and then we're going to come back and I'm going to take a look at some gear. We're going to look at this little interface and microphone kit that Rode sent me, because those of you who are learning to record, you're definitely going to want to check this out. Especially if you don't have any gear. Again, I keep saying Rode is probably like the best bang for your buck these days, and I genuinely mean that. Everyone that hears me use these microphones or hears how they sound with the recordings is typically very impressed with it. And, you know, when you're starting out, it can be, there's a lot of gear nowadays that is very, very good quality that is very inexpensive. It is no longer the time where cheap equals bad, but at the same time, you have to know what things they are, because there are some cheap things that are bad. But this one I think is going to be awesome, which is this Rode kit here. You see, it comes with the interface for you. And a microphone and a bunch of other things actually inside this box for what you need to record. So if you really want to get your start as a vocal recording, you might want this kit. So when I come back, we're going to take a look at this. That will be the last thing we do before I open everything up for submissions to have me react to your vocals. And so we're going to take a look at this in just a few minutes. So I'm going to pause the stream, and then we're going to come back in about 15 minutes. So at about 3:30, so it's 15 after now, at 30 after, we will come back here. So thanks, everybody.
What's up, everybody? So, already we've got some questions. This is good. I have a question. It might have been from before I left. I feel like it's hidden, though. Why can't I see it? I didn't see it on the screen. Anyway, streaming. This is much better than it used to be for me. So, guys, just realize, too, everybody who's learning to get into this stuff, I have to learn it, too. I'm not just magically knowing these things, and I have to have a lot of trial and error, and you guys have been with me for a lot of it, and that's fine, because that's just how it is. It's just life, so you gotta adapt to technology. Half the time, you do it while you're doing it, during the execution, so you will make mistakes. It's really more you can't be afraid to make a little mistakes, like stumbling down a gravel road, it's like... what it's like learning something, I think, nowadays. And headphone hair. Don't be afraid of headphone hair. You're definitely going to have it. Okay, let's take a look at some equipment. If Paul, wherever he went, wants to... Wait a minute. Hold on. Maybe I'm not looking at all the messages. I don't know. If you want... It doesn't look like the question ever went through. So if you want to re-enter your question, you can do that. That's fine with me. So let's look at some gear, folks. We have not had a chance to look at some equipment. And I want to look at this package that Rode sent me. So a lot of you guys were just watching me record and learning how to record for the first time. Or maybe, you have... oh, by the way, did you guys see the chomp is back? He came back in from outside. So anyway, let's go ahead and take a look at the package they sent me. I love this microphone company. They're based out of Australia. And so this is an all-in-one kit. So if you got this, let me turn my microphone back up a little bit. I'm not recording any more screams, so I can turn the volume of the input back up for my speaking. So I keep saying these things because there's a lot of folks learning here. For those of you that are experienced, like myself, this is going to be obvious, but then you're not going to be here with me. You're going to be on the Nail the Mix advanced tutorials and things like that. You're not, So let's take a look here. This is this cool little interface kit. Actually, I think this could be great for any vocalist. I took the interface out and took a picture of it. If you follow me on Instagram, Metal Mary Z, you will see the picture I took, and I was holding it, and it fits in the palm of my hand. It's a great little interface. I haven't plugged it in yet or tried it out, so we're going to do that today and see what's in here. Let's unbox this bad boy first. So they just name their products whatever it is plus whatever number in the series it is. So it's like this is the AI one. Audio interface one. Actually, I don't know for their microphone what NT stands for, because most of their stuff, it's very direct, like shock mount. It's like SM for them. So I'm not sure what NT stands for. The NT1 is the microphone in this case. So let me slide this open. But this is a kit. This comes with a whole bunch of things, like all the things that you would need to record. So I think that for those of you that are getting started, it kind of couldn't beat that. So let's see. We're going to open the box here. I love these guys because they'll always give you a quick start guide here. Very easy little setup guide if you're a noob, and you want to take a look at that. Also, there's this little blue ring here for your XLR cables. This keeps your connection nice and tight and snug. So XLR connections can get loose over time. I think this is so neat. There's so many little touches they add to their products that make it worth buying. Like I said, you're probably getting your best bang for your buck from these guys. And then they always give me little stickers.
I wish I could give those to you guys because I'm just, I have them and it's just like probably too weird to mail it though. Okay, so there's several little boxes inside the big box. The first box we get is this thing called, this is what I was talking about, naming it after what it is. This is the Shock Mount 6, SM6. And so this is the shock mount that the microphone goes in, but it also has this pop filter on it. And that's because it came with a condenser mic. It's not like their dynamic mics, the pod mic and the Procaster and things. It's going to need a pop filter. So it's really cool. They give you the shock mount and pop filter. How rad. Let's take it out. I don't know why I'm singing to myself. Just, you know what? We should listen to music while we're doing this. What would you guys want to listen to? Actually, I might just pick. I might subject you to something. We might just put on some, like, instrumentals. I don't know. But it seems quiet in between if I'm not listening to some jams here. Okay, so I'm taking this out of the box. And we're going to set those aside. And here is the shock mount. And I love this because the pop filter's coming unattached. And their pop filters are great because they have all these extra like joints in them. There are several places there are joints that you can really adjust everything. I really like that. Not everything is like that. It's so cool. So next thing I'm going to do is there are several more boxes in here. Here is the interface, the AI one, and this is very small, you can see, and also has its own little quick start guide here. They're not leaving you hanging, but what a neat kit. I love these little kits. Oh, interesting. It says at the top here that you also get free Ableton Live light for buying this. So, it comes with what we were talking about earlier, a DAW, a digital audio workstation. Ableton is one of them, and this seems to be like a light version that it comes with for free, so you get some audio software if you would like it. Otherwise, you know, we've been talking about these other ones. Reaper is free. GarageBand is $10, or it comes free with your computer. But that's only for Mac, though. So, okay, so here's our cute little interface. You can see that this is very small. And this is what plugs into your computer, for those of you who are new. How cool. We have a nice updated USB-C port here that goes into your computer there. And we have the right and left speaker outputs on the back. Okay. And then over here in the front, we have a dual input. This can be either a microphone cable or an instrument cable, it looks like. So you can plug in one thing at a time. So it means you can record one thing. So you can use this to record vocals with only. And that's why it's a great kit for a vocalist, because just what you need for vocals. You can use a nice microphone. It's not a USB mic. It's a small interface, though. You can put this in your backpack. You can take this anywhere. This is great. And I have a free USB-C cable, so we're going to hook it up with that, and we're actually going to use it. Oh, somebody did something. Oh, thank you for following. Yeah, thanks, everybody. When you follow and subscribe, and it throws a little love at you there, which I really appreciate. Yeah, so it's very cool. So let me just put that there. Okay, there are two more boxes in here because they give you everything you need. They do not leave you hanging. Best kits ever. I've been very impressed with these guys. Okay, here's a little microphone bag. You definitely want to use that. This must be the microphone in here. So let's pull it out. Okay, yeah, that's the box. Bye. And this is the microphone. And you want to keep this silica gel thing. This, don't throw that out. Because if you live in a humid climate, you will open up your boxes and find your mics rusted out. So these are metal components. Just keep the silica gel in the bag when you get it, okay? So I took it out. I kept it. We're going to keep it in here. And you're going to, you want to store it in a proper case. When a microphone company gives you a case, that's what you need to store it in. But I like this because it's a bag and it's not bulky. And again, this in the interface, I could fit in my purse if I wanted to. Okay. So this though would go inside the shock mount, and with a condenser microphone, this little thing here is indicating what is the front, this gold button here on the Rode microphones, and where you should be singing into. You should be singing into that gold button. That's the front of it. That's the diaphragm. And you sing this way into it. This is not a microphone you sing like this, or you don't hold your hand on it. You sing into it this way. Okay. And we'll put it in the shock mount, and you'll see in a minute. Okay. So we got our little bag here. How cute. A little satchel. And let's see. Okay, so, oh, and this, they give you a cable. So, again, every little thing that you need comes in the kit. How effing neat. Because that's, like, the big problem. You know, you get, you're new to recording. You don't have all these extra things laying around. And you're going to need to go get it. Hold on. I think there's one other thing I'm missing. Oh, it has a 10-year warranty on these things. That's amazing. Okay, hold on. There is a USB cable somewhere in this kit as well, and it's not in here with the microphone cable. That's what I was looking for. Because you're going to, you know, you want a kit that as a vocalist, you can just plug and play, and this is definitely it. I am super impressed. I love their microphone cables, though. They've done really good by me. So here's one. It came with the kit, and you would definitely need that. This is what you plug your microphone into your interface with, okay? If you're more experienced, you know that, of course. Let's see. Aha. So back in the box where the interface came, there is a USB cable for you. So they gave you absolutely everything. And I felt this way about their vlogger kit too. It was just incredible. Oh, this is great. So yeah, this is a USB-C to regular USB cable. So if you don't have a USB-C input or USB-C to USB-C yet, you know, this is just going to your regular USB. And I'm not going to use that. I'm going to try to use my USB-C here, the Thunderbolt cable, and see if that will work. And so we're going to plug it in the interface, and we are going to check it out. Oh, yeah, I was saying we should have some tunes. We need some jams while I'm doing this part, because it just feels empty in here without them. So look at Chompy in the back. He's so cute, right? He loves sleeping on that thing. He says, thanks for watching the stream, you guys. So, so yes, later today, why can't I open this? We're going to be reacting to your vocals, hopefully, if you have any vocals to show me. And I'm going to tell you about how to do that in a little bit. That'll be the last thing we do for today. Let's listen to some jams. Oh, I gotta turn it way down. I want it to be way quieter than my voice. But it's October, so let's listen to some like goth stuff in the background. So anyway, we're going to keep going here, and I'm just getting this cable out. I have no idea why it's so difficult for me to open this. Apparently, I have no idea what I'm doing. But this is not Rode's cable. This is a cable I bought for my computer. Their cable was readily available. So anyway, all right, cool. This is out. And we're going to plug in the interface, and we're going to see what is happening with it. And let's see. See if it will work with this Thunderbolt. It probably will. And by the way, the interface I think should just work It's not like back in the day, I don't think, where you need to install drivers or anything. I could be eating my words, actually. Let me just look at that in this manual really quick while we're plugging it in. Okay. Yeah, I don't see any need for drivers or anything like that. So, I thought it should be in 2021. At least what I think it should be. I'm sorry, guys. I'm standing here so I can plug this in. So, do any of you guys have interfaces, and what do you use? In? I don't know. We'll see. Do I? Oh, yeah. It's plugged in. So I have this plugged in now on top of my regular interface. I have an Audient ID 14 that everything is going through from my microphone right now. And so now the Rode interface is plugged in, but I'm not going through it yet. Let's get the microphone situated in the shock mount. So you want to, there's two sides to this. This side here with the empty hole is for your pop filter. That's the side you will be singing into. This side here with the little screw that goes on top of your microphone stand. Or in my case, it's going to go like this because I have this microphone stand that's like that. So yeah, because I'm going to probably attach it right here to this. So we're going to put this on here, and yeah, thanks for hanging with me, everybody. And if you're enjoying the content, you can use the super chat, you can leave me a little tip if you feel so inclined. We're gonna do some reacting a little bit to your vocals. Let's see. Okay, great. So now I have it set up facing what will be the pop filter, and this is the goal facing you. This is how you sing into it. So oops. There we go. I'm just tightening it. It screws on to here. So you tighten it, and then it stays. And the shock mount is basically because these are way more sensitive microphones. And that way, if it gets bumped or moved, it doesn't really translate into the recording because that can happen. So, and then I'm going to screw on the pop filter just so that we have it all set up. And we're going to put that there. So, are you guys going as anything for Halloween? So I'm screwing this on to the pop filter onto the shock mount here so that we can test this out. You need a pop filter because this might seem strange to those of you who are new to recording, but you can hear it when I get close. P's and B's. This one has a lot of built-in protection from those. I had to really mess it up to get in there. But these other microphones are more sensitive. They don't. And so you're going to have to... man, I feel like this just doesn't want to go in right now. Ah, there we go. Now I got it. All right. Okay, here we go. We got this pop filter on here. All right. Yes. Okay. So this adjusts it, like, flapping this direction. So.
Oh, it came out.
What the heck? I just said I didn't have it screwed in all the way. So. There we go. We're going to tie this tight. There we go. So, boom. And you're going to sing into this. You want this a little bit away from the microphone. You're going to sing right here into the microphone. And then this thing's going to catch all your P's and B's. That's what they call it, a pop filter. Then I'm going to go ahead and plug it with the cable into the interface. And then we are going to try to use the interface and hear what it sounds like and see if it will let me use it. Hopefully I won't have to restart the computer or anything to try it out. But at least you guys got to see it put together. So now it's all plugged in. I'm going to take this. I'm just going to throw it on my mic stand here. Which means that my mic is going to come undone from here for a second. So. But that's all right. Because we're doing a demo. I'll still have it out here. So you can basically hear me. We're going to go through this other mic in a second, but I just wanted to get it put on to the stand. This is a funky stand for this kind of microphone, so it's kind of weird how it's going to look in here. Okay, I got to readjust. All right, so this is falling a little bit. So I'm going to grab this and put this up a little bit more. Stay with this one. There we go. Okay, now it's set up and I can sing right into it. But I haven't actually plugged in this interface. So, let's see. I'm gonna see where to get to put this input. Let's see. Audio input. Okay. Let's try that. And let's see if we can get our road box going. Cause I'm still coming through this mic. And I guess this one is plugged into the new interface. So, aha! It just automatically came up. The Rode AI-1. I'm going to select it. We're going to lose our tunes for a minute, but then we're going to hear what the new interface sounds like. Shoot, I dropped something. So. I just gotta look at how they want to turn on the phantom power here. Aha, very easy. Okay, you turn the phantom power on here by pressing in on the button, on the volume button. And so you can turn it off or turn it on. You need this thing called phantom power for condenser mics. For dynamic mics, you do not need them.
So, I'm not sure. I'm just trying to get this road. And this has nothing to do. The device showed up right away as an input for my computer. But I feel like it's not coming through the, streaming software at the moment. So let me just see if I can fix it. But thanks everybody for coming in. Hi, how's it going? It's going great for me here. I'm testing out the, for everybody just joining, while I'm working on this shenanigans over here, I'm testing out the Rode new interface, and it's working great. I'm just trying to get it connected to my streaming software so you guys can hear what it sounds like. Because right now it is, maybe it doesn't want to connect because maybe I would have to restart or something, but... it did allow me to select it right away without any drivers or any software or anything, so it's great so far. And it's all in one kit, and we're just testing it out right now and just checking it out and seeing how it's going. Let's see here. Oh no. Yeah, this one didn't need any interface or any drivers or anything at all. It just showed up. Well, I don't know why. Let's see if I can get it to connect to a DAW. And we'll see if I can do it there, because then I can still send it to y'all from my streaming software. So, yeah, I'm telling you, this was really easy. You shouldn't need any drivers or anything. There's nothing about that in the instructions. It was plug and play. So, this is the Rode microphone interface. So, let me just see here. I'm going to open up Reaper. And we're going to try to use it over there. Let's open up that same session I had for the Chimera. Earlier we were learning to record. I was demonstrating recording some Hirsch vocals. So let's see here. Give me 1 second, guys. Okay, so let's see if I can get this to work with the DAW here. I don't know if... and then I just want to hear it and see if... okay, here we go. Device. Let's try it. Rode AI one. Okay. All right, let me see here if I'm hearing it through the AI one or through my interface. Check. Okay, hold on. I might have to pause our jams. Everything for a minute. I'm gonna go ahead and mute my tunes here. Mm-hmm. So we're going to see if we can't hear this interface here. So let's try it.
So let's try to, so basically I couldn't get that to connect to the stream, but I got to tell you, it was pretty much plug and play though. I think if I could stop the stream and restart the computer, that you guys would be able to hear out of it. But I cannot. So I think that's really the only thing I would have to do, is close out some of my software and restart it. But it doesn't appear to need any drivers or anything like that. So I think all it would take was a quick computer restart. And that's all you would need to do. So I think that it's a really great interface. And I'm sure it works amazing. Whoa. I'm back to having my proper interface here. So, yeah. It did not really work without probably restarting the computer. So, but this is a great little device, and I'm so glad we had a chance to do a little unboxing and put it together. And I'm going to put my regular microphone back on here so that I can keep talking to you guys in the stream. And yes, hello to everybody who's joining. Hello. So what I want to do next with you guys, so that was the unboxing of the Rode AI-1. I should have realized plugging it in live was probably, for the first time, not a good idea, because I usually would need a, yeah, I know, the mic probably switched to stereo. I have this other software that I had to get into while I was trying to do that, and it won't let me go back in there now, because, yeah, trying to plug in this interface live definitely screwed up a little bit of my audio. So anyway, guys, so I wanted to do reactions to you guys live today, but I may have to restart the stream or something, because I think I need to get my audio settings back, and to do that, I think I have to close out the streaming software. So I might just save that. I might just table that, reacting to you guys live, for a different stream, because as soon as I restart, it's going to script the link and everything like that. So that's what I get for trying to plug in an interface live here. Because just realize, even if it's really plug and play like this and it doesn't need any drivers, even a brand new computer is probably going to need a computer restart. You usually have to like close out your software and reopen it. That's as simple as it is. But I will tell you, without closing it and reopen it, it recognized the device. So even though it didn't want to entirely connect, that's pretty amazing to have like a driverless device that's just plug and play. And it didn't, I use a Mac, but it didn't seem to indicate that a PC would be any different. So in their instructions. So what a cool device. Rode has this great interface. You guys should all try it out. I'm sure it works amazing. I will get it plugged in or working when I restart later, but I don't want to have to come back and start another stream link. So, and plus my talking voice is starting to go a little bit. You guys can hear that because I've been spending so much time with you. So I wanted to say thank you guys. Thanks to everybody who threw a little tip in the super chat and a little tip in the jar for me on the stream. I really appreciate that. I'm going to leave this full stream up on YouTube, actually, which before I wasn't. I was taking them down and then cutting them out. So if you guys want to do that, check it out. That's fine. And then I'm going to do some cutouts just for some YouTube videos to isolate some of the best sections for you guys. But I will leave this one up as well. So I hope it was a good and informative time for you guys. I wanted to do more, but it's just, you have to realize I've got to talk the whole time and you can hear my voice starting to give out. And so we'll table reacting to your material for the next stream. So thank you guys for your patience with me on that. And we'll do some more singing and screaming next week. So hopefully I can do streams more often now that I have everything set up. Thank you guys for sticking with me. I'll keep my regular content videos going as well. So bye everybody. Thanks so much for an excellent stream. Thanks to Rode Mics for all the amazing gear you're hearing me speaking through. This is Rode Mics as well. The pod mic. This is a great mic for the